Hello, hello, everybody. It is 4:01 p.m. Central Time on the 6th of July, 2017. Welcome into the Earthquake 3D live stream. And for those of you who are new here, we have about six or seven new chat rooms in. So if you're new, let me quickly explain. You are looking at a three-dimensional globe showing the past 48 hours worth of earthquakes around the planet. And we also issue semi-daily and weekly earthquake forecasts here on my channel for new areas to watch for movement to strike. And let me tell you something, guys. Starting this morning, early hours of this morning here in the States, we started a very active day. And if you're in the United States, you probably already know about what I'm about to tell you. But if you're not, let me bring you up to speed. A new 6.0 range earthquake, 5.9, 5.8, they ultimately went with a 5.8 and Big Swarm, struck in Montana about 130 miles northwest of Yellowstone. That's right, guys, near Yellowstone. Now, it's not a sign of an eruption, so let me just head off at the pass. If you're worried about that, don't worry about an eruption. This is on the northern tip of the magma chamber for Yellowstone, which they found goes up into Montana, over through Idaho, all the way over to the Idaho-Oregon border, and then comes back around an oval shape back into Yellowstone Park here in northwest Wyoming, where the 2.5 now is. There's a subsequent 2.5 inside the park. We can expect that there's going to be other earthquakes down along the red line coming out of where this earthquake is. So this is a big enough earthquake to cause damage, to wake people up in the middle of the night, scare the heck out of people, and certainly leave them wondering as to whether or not there's going to be any more movement. Now, I just turned on a display capture so you can see what I see. We're going to go over to ABC News, where I saw an article that I just got to bring out, you know, just as an example of something we got to pay attention to for BS factor. Okay, now here's the story. They put the Montana earthquake smashes bottles, jolts residents awake. Okay, that's probably an accurate headline. I'm certainly positive that it would knock things off shelves and maybe even cause damage to brick structures, but it would not be strong enough to snap a tree in half. A tree was snapped in half by a 5.8 magnitude earthquake felt in Helena, Montana on Thursday, July 6, 2017. Okay. If the quake was strong enough to break a tree in half like this, if the tree was not already weakened, okay, they would need to imply that the tree was also struck by lightning and teetering on the edge of collapse, and then the earthquake hit. Because if an earthquake knocked down a tree like that, it would also knock down the other trees nearby, and it would knock down the brick structure right behind it, take off the chimney behind it for certain. And so we can definitely say, if you see stuff like this, that that's BS. So we got to watch for the BS reports to start coming out, and I'm not surprised that the fake news would be putting this out today. So mainstream media is fake news. Anybody with a brain would start to say, hey, what about the brick structure? Like, what? Okay. But it did happen, and it did cause damage. Now, I haven't seen any videos, and I haven't seen any major damage, but if you live there, you might want to go inspect your foundation. You might want to go inspect driveways, sidewalks, and bridges that are nearby you. If you don't have people that are inspecting them yourselves, go check and see. You might want to go look, because an earthquake this size is big enough to cause damage. Now, you're probably wondering, where did it come from? Where did this 6.0 earthquake come from? It's the biggest earthquake since 1975, guys, 41 years. Okay, so where did the pressure come from? It came from the north. See the edge of the craton? See where it is here on the red arrow? Follow the red arrow back up and it goes up into the Arctic Circle. Well, what's right here? This is an area called Nunavut, Canada. And many of my viewers who are tuned in right now might remember that name from just this week when a 7.1 earthquake showed up here in Nunavut and they deleted the earthquake. We all saw it. I showed it on the stream. Okay. Now, again, they do that. We sometimes think it's a mistake. Well, now I think it's pretty obvious that it wasn't. So the earthquake that struck up here in the Arctic Circle, just because no one was there to feel it, doesn't mean it didn't happen. So 7.1 in the Arctic Circle then pushed down on the edge of the craton and caused new activity on the edge of the craton at the magma chamber for Yellowstone. That's what happened. Now, what caused the 7.1 up in Nunavut? Anybody know? We'll go back a couple more days. to Bogoslav volcano erupting for the first time this past week in several weeks of being silent. So Bogoslav sent off a new blast, then a 7.1 hit in Nunavut, now a 6.0 record earthquake in the last 40 years has hit in the continental United States on the interior edge of the craton. Just as expected, this morning, new activity broke out in Oklahoma, 2.5 and 3.5. This is a big increase from where we were, which was nothing. So we went from 0 to 3.5. That's a 100-fold increase in power, almost 1,000-fold if we go up just another couple, a half point, would take us up a 1,000-fold increase in power, going from nothing to 4.0 earthquake. But I'm just going to go show you what's at the earthquake epicenter so you can see for yourself. Okay, so we're zooming in on the area. Here we are. We're in beautiful Oklahoma, and we got some farm fields nearby, but I'm concerned with this. Okay, this right here is a perfect example of what's called a frack well, where they've drilled down into the crust by several hundred to several thousand feet, and they inject what's called wastewater. Now, wastewater is just a creative word for chemical-laden water that's designed to break down the shale, and they leave the chemical water down in the well, and oil and gas float up to the top, and they siphon that off. So, here, great examples all throughout here. Every single one of these little square pads is a different drill point, and when I back it out, and you start to see how many there are, and they just go on and on in all directions for miles and miles, and then right at the middle of here, we get an earthquake. That's what the cause is. The cause is the drill point. But where did the pressure come from? I mean, why did it rapidly just go back up to near 4.0 all of a sudden? Well, obviously, pressure transfers down the edge of the craton from the northwest to the southeast, and it has re-excited things back up already in Oklahoma within just a few hours of this all occurring. This all happened this morning, guys. This earthquake here, and now the 3.5 in the Midwest. Now, if you're on the West Coast, well, I've got some good news, and I've got some bad news for you, I suppose. Which would you like first? For the people in the Midwest, again, or you're going to be getting a brunt of this. For the people on the West Coast, you're going to be spared most of this. So, pressure goes to the east by southeast, not to the south by southwest, which means Southern California, while there is a slight possibility you might see an increase, most of the increase is going to go to the east, all the way up the East Coast, into Quebec and New Brunswick and Maine in the next few days. If you live up in the Northeast, you're going to see new earthquakes, probably in the 3 range. Probably. It could go up upper 2, but it'll be a dramatic increase from where we were, which is absolutely nothing. It may be a 0 or a 1 happening. Now, to speak of the 0s and 1s, we'll get into that in a second, and we'll talk about the slow slope as well in a second. But I want to show you the other spots that were hit today. That's not the only spot, guys. We had a 7.0 earthquake, now downgraded to 6.5, strike over here in the Philippines, in the West Pacific. Now, guys, it was a 6.9. They downgraded to 6.5. I don't care what they downgraded to. That's a 6.9 striking right next to the 6.9 from the day before that they deleted, or 2 days before. So a few days ago, a 6.9 struck right here, right next to the area we warned. We warned Papua New Guinea, and an earthquake 6.9 struck right next to it. It was on the feeds. It was here on Earthquake 3D. I reported it, said, I don't know what's going on here, guys. It just popped on the feed. Said we would wait to see whether or not there was any follow-up movement that would indicate whether or not the 6.9 happened, and then another 6.9 hit just to the north. I would say that's confirmation. The first 6.9 was indeed an accurate earthquake that did occur. The Russians reported it. People made videos on YouTube calling me out over it, saying it was wrong for me to report the earthquake and tell people about it. Well, now we know those people are idiots. Check it out. 6.9 struck right next to the area. The person who made the video, I'm not going to mention their name, said that nothing happened. Man, you know somebody died over here? Somebody died in this earthquake. Now, while I was busy fighting a guy on YouTube who was trying to say that it didn't happen, we should have been taking the time to warn the people even more in the area nearby the 6.9. Doesn't that mean the person who was trying to fight me over the 6.9 actually may be somewhat responsible for the injuries and deaths that may have occurred? I mean, preventing a warning? I mean, imagine it this way. You're out in the field. You're watching the weather. You're a trained spotter. You're seeing a tornado. You're not a trained spotter. You're an average citizen. And you're out in the field and you see a tornado forming. You pick up the phone. You dial 911 to make the report. Some guy comes up, grabs the phone out of your hand, says, that's not a tornado, and throws it in the ground. And then the tornado forms and hits a couple houses. Isn't that guy who stopped the report of the tornado responsible for the potential deaths of those people for preventing the warning? I'd say they might be, and that's exactly what I had to deal with this week. So here we are, the earthquake has struck right next to it, and man, it's big, okay? So where did it come from overall? Well, it's the center of the previous several days' activity. You go back several days, all the earthquakes struck right in here, right next to Dukono, going over around Indonesia. That's been happening, the volcanic eruptions, it's the middle of that. Mount Sinabung, Dukono, Langila, Bagana, and next to the 6.9. That's not all that struck today, guys. How about the coast of Japan? How about the coast of Japan being struck right where we issued the warning? 5.1 earthquake, falling within the realm of acceptability for the magnitude. I think we were looking up to a 5.3 to 5.4, so we're just a couple points off. Coast of Honshu, south of Hokkaido, right on the spot that we issued the warning for. If you're in Japan, that is the earthquake we were looking for, guys. You can check it off the list if you were keeping track of areas that I named. Also, down to the south, at Guam, at the bend, a mid-range 4 striking. While I'm not surprised to see a mid-range 4 striking, that's from the previous day's mid-range 4s up to the north. So we had a 4 up to the north, now a 4 down to the south. We can certainly expect that to compensate in the next couple days. But that's not all that hit today, guys. Look what else hit. The triangular bend at the Solomon Islands at the halfway fulcrum point between the volcano and the deep earthquake, a new 5.4 hit. Well, I'm not shocked by that because we had a deep 4.4 a day and a half ago. I'll mark that for you in blue right here. Hold on. Whoops. There we go. Marked in blue. It's this earthquake raised high off the globe right here. That deep 4.4 has caused a shallow 5.4 right next to it in the silent zone. Check that area off the list if you were keeping track of areas that we named. Also, that's another spot that was hit in the area that we named. The central point at New Zealand was hit by a mid-range 4 on the North Island, the Catcher's Mitt. Catcher's Mitt hit by a mid-range 4 at the plate boundary near Wellington, guys. If you were keeping track of areas that we named, check off the central area, check off the North Island. That's a double whammy, and you've got a new deep earthquake up to your north to contend with in the next day and a half. Also, new activity that spread out smaller, but still somewhat deep, at the Catcher's Mitt, going down into the North Island. So how many is that? New Zealand hit as expected. Solomon Islands into Vanuatu hit as expected. Philippines hit next to the 6.9 as expected. Japan hit as expected. Now let's get down into South America. Take a look at our two big arrows. See the big arrows? Look where the arrows point. Look what got hit, guys. Mid-range 4 to 5.0 earthquake in North Peru at the Ecuador border. We were talking about North Peru right throughout here. It's a little bit north. I'm going to call this actually an earthquake forecast miss since it's over 200 miles. We were looking right here, and instead it hit right here. Okay, but that's the earthquake. So even though it's over 200 miles, it's an earthquake forecast miss, but, I mean, that is the earthquake. Same-sized earthquake struck down at the south within a couple points, 4.3 down at the south tip. Okay, so the only thing left to happen off this now would be another 4.5 or 5.0 earthquake to strike in the middle, next to Sapancaya Volcano near Bolivia-Chile border, and for a 5 to 6.0 in that range, one magnitude range, 5 to 6, striking out here in the middle of nowhere, down in the South Sandwich Islands, north of Antarctica, where the X is. That's a termination point for the pressure. But that's not all that happened today. Even more occurred, guys, over here in Europe. Take a look at this. A new 4.0 earthquake struck last night in Macedonia. So Macedonia is, let me just show it to you here, right here at the center. And we told you we were about to repeat everything from the day before. It was about to repeat again. Well, take a look at what happened. A swarm broke out, went up into North Bosnia, right at the North Italy border, near Serbia. I guess that's technically Slovenia. I'm sorry, Slovenia. Also, over here to the east, a new round of earthquakes striking on the Romanian Craton edge of Europe. So there it is, both spots being hit, and central Italy, south Italy being hit. A 4.0 earthquake struck last night at the south boot heel of Italy. They downgraded it to 3.7, but I believe this is what's coming off of the previous day's 4 down here at Crete. So we got a 4 at Crete that has now pushed up into south Italy, caused a 3.7. It's also caused a new swarm, Norcia, going north towards Florence. So to see the new swarm, Norcia, going north to Florence, Let's quickly turn on the INGV last 150 reported events, 0.0 and greater. Well, wait for it to populate. As it's populating, let me just quickly tell you, a 4 in South Italy and a swarm in Central Italy, that means pressure has been reintroduced to Italy. I don't need to even really explain that. A kid could even understand this. So now that we have new earthquakes stacking up in South Italy and Central Italy, the spot to watch for new 4.0 activity is going to be Central Italy into North Italy, just as expected, between Torino, Milan, and down to Norcia. It's a kind of a backwards R-shape bend here in North Italy, going up to the tip of the Red Arrow and down to the swarm of earthquakes. It's a few hundred mile stretch. The whole region should be hit. So in the next several days, we should see North Italy and Central Italy light up even more. So we have a stack, and the stack of earthquakes here has increased in magnitudes. There were zeros and ones, okay? And then it went from ones and twos to twos and near threes. And that's where we are now. I'm looking for it to go up a whole nother notch. Up to 4.9 is potential. Time frame on this. Look, guys, we're here. We are here. It is on your doorstep. It shouldn't be but a few hours going into tomorrow. Now, I said if it didn't hit by tonight, I would cancel the warning, and I stick to that. If it doesn't hit by tonight, my time, let's say by like 10 or 11 o'clock, if we get on by tonight and it hasn't hit, I will cancel the warning for Central Italy, and we'll readjust it, and we'll try and figure out where the energy went. But it is there. To me, it's there. There's a 4 down to the south. You got a swarm at the center. What more do you need? It's on your doorstep. If there was somebody coming up to your door, they are now getting ready to knock on it. That's another way to look at it. Central America, there is something going on here, and the something is nothing. There is no earthquake activity happening across Central America. But let's go quickly consult the volcanic eruption feed, because what you'll see on the eruption feed is that Popocatépetl in Mexico starting to send off new blasts. Sabancaya still going, of course, but Popo is the repeat offender over here in the East Pacific. That's it. There is no other activity. So we went from all of this erupting across Central America. Let me name them for you. Rincon, Turrialba, and Poes, all three erupting here. Fuego erupting here in Guatemala. And Colima erupting several times. That alone, those all stopped. And now that's been replaced by one right in the middle. Popocatépetl erupting several times now. And a couple of those blasts being very, very impressive. So that's a dramatic decrease in volcanic activity, but we're focusing in right on the center of the zone. The center of what? The center of the silent zone. You've got earthquakes to the north in the United States, and you've got earthquakes all the way to the south in South America. Right in the middle of all that, you've got one volcano popping over and over again. Going down to the south, Reventador stopped erupting here in Ecuador, and the only one going is right in the middle of South America, Sabancaya. So middle of South America going, middle of Central America going. Is the middle of the North American continent going? Well, where is it going? You bet it is, but it's going at Yellowstone's magma chamber. So what do all these areas have in common, those three areas on the continent? The middle point of the United States and Canada, North American continent, being hit at Yellowstone, at the volcano. Then you go down to the south, middle of Central America, being hit where? At the volcano. And you go all the way down to the south in South America, and it's being hit at the center at the volcano as well with new eruptions. So I would say that pressure is seeking out each continent's fulcrum point. It's pretty obvious, isn't it? So if we have an earthquake striking at the center here, what's going on the coast of the United States? Isn't there something we might want to pay attention to on the coast of the United States? Something that, you know, we've been looking at for the last several months that might stand out to us? Here, let's look at 24 hours worth of slow slip tremors and see if there's any change. Oh, well, there certainly is. In 24 hours, we've now got a list that I've kind of have to scroll down. We're over 40 events now in 24 hours. 48 hours, take it back even further. Now we're at about 50 or 60 events. But we'll take it down to 24, and you'll see an even distribution of tremors across Northern California, Oregon, and Washington. The whole slow slip region is moving on a slight basis right now with several microquakes, several tremors. What does that mean? Well, let me get you over and show that to you on Google Earth so you can see actual imagery of the undersea fracture zones here off the coast. Now, the spots that are moving are on land. here, south of Olympia, up north at the Puget Sound, going south across Oregon, all of Oregon, and down into Northern California. All right, well, that's all on land, and there's a bunch of mountains right there, and then there's a bunch of volcanoes on the eastern edge of the mountains. But the spot that's moving is pretty much right here at the center. Okay, so what's going on offshore? Look out to sea. See this? The biggest fracture zone in North America? Okay, this is the Juan de Fuca fracture zone. This is also the Cascadia quote-unquote subduction zone. Well, we're looking at the fracture zone off the coast, the S or Z-shaped Juan de Fuca. Something off the coast is currently pushing onto land right now. So if it's moving on land, something's pushing out to sea. You also have to take into account that this one right here is caused by a 7.1 coming in from the north, which means there's a lot of pressure coming in from the north as well, but it's seeking out the interior edge of the craton to go across the plate. I suppose that's good news for the West Coast. You got grazed by a bullet. Okay, if that 7.1 had struck right here instead of right here, it would push down the edge of the craton or the edge of the plate and on the western side and go right into here. Okay, so you got lucky. And we don't like relying on luck in science, but that's the facts. So the 7.1 reported up in Nunavut caused this new earthquake down here near Yellowstone. But we're looking off the coast for something at least greater than this. Greater than that. I mean, look, we're one state off, one and a half states off. Warning. So if we issued for a 5 to 6.0 type earthquake to look out for here, we were looking for a 5 to strike off the coast, and it strikes right here, well, that's probably not related the way the pressure flows. So if we're looking for an earthquake off the coast and it hasn't hit yet, we still have to watch for it, unfortunately, I guess is my ultimate point of this. Now, magnitudes on this, we've got a couple things going on. Look at all the fives that have hit around the plate in the past couple days. Now, let me turn on 5.0 and greater so you can really get a good look on this. West Pacific, East Pacific, even Northwest United States, Intermountain West. But West Coast, nothing. Alaska, nothing. You only have fours. So you're going to fill in. Mexico, like I said, you got new volcanic blasts happening in the middle there for you. But everywhere else over here in the Pacific has been hit by that 5.0 activity in the past few days. So it stands to reason that there's a few spots that should be filled in that are normally prone that have not been hit. You know, another spot I probably could get away with warning right now would be the Gulf of California yet once again. We need to warn the northern part of the Gulf of California. You might even feel this if it strikes in that 5 range. Between 5.8 to the north and 5.1 to the south. We're not going to add those together since most of this 5.8 pressure is going to be going over to the east. But still, we got two fives on either side of the zone. We got a volcanic eruption in the middle. We might need to get a warning out to the people there. Let them know that a 5 is potential. Let's put it at a 5.3 to 5.4 potential. It's not exactly, I wouldn't normally issue a warning like this, but because of the 5.8 up to the north, we kind of do have to warn the halfway point between the halfway points. So you got the eruption happening here, and you've got earthquakes that have snuck down the coast and struck last night right here at the California-Arizona border, sorry. And then the halfway point between the volcano and that point brings us right in here. Just as a heads up. I mean, just to give you an example of another halfway point that will be hit. So I think that's a brief recap for what's going on around the planet. And we haven't even got into what to watch for in the West Pacific now that this has all started to take place. How about over in Asia? A lack of earthquakes here right now across India, Nepal, Myanmar. Okay, you guys need to be warned right now. Right now, because within 3 to 4 days, at the most, 3 to 4 days from now, we're going to see pressure escape out of the West Pacific, come up and around, and head out towards Europe. Europe, you have a 4 to 5 day warning at the most right now for a dramatic increase in activity. Now, why am I saying there's going to be a dramatic increase instead of just a slight increase? Well, first of all, we got a 7.0 right here in the middle. Right here in the middle of all of it. We have all those volcanic eruptions, which are now starting to die out, and they're being replaced by earthquakes. So a flurry of 5.0 activity developing out. Thirdly, there's been 3 new deep earthquakes in the last 2 days. Take a look at it. 2 right here, south of Fiji and the 500-kilometer depth range, 535 and 538. Okay, so right next to each other depth-wise. Then getting up here on the Izu Ridge, take a look at it, guys, 206 kilometers deep, about half the depth of these, but it's still a deep earthquake. And if we go back just another day, go back one more day, we have the other deep earthquake. So really, you see these raised high off the globe. This indicates the deep earthquake event is carrying on. There was something else that showed up yesterday on the Mimic TPW that we talked about, and maybe I should just pull that up so you can see it. Mimic TPW. And what we're going to open up is the global microwave background imagery. And what we're going to look at is in the South Atlantic, you're going to see some interesting waveforms appear and come across the screen. See that? And then that. All right. That is not a man-made signal, guys. That is Mother Nature reflecting on the same bandwidth, 27 to 35 gigahertz, that they're using to observe moisture in the atmosphere. So microwaves actually can be reflected if there's certain types of energy, what's called plasma, reflecting out of the atmosphere. So charged particles in the atmosphere will reflect like they're moisture or a solid. And in this case, it's like a waveform because the computer doesn't know how to decode that. It just sees it and thinks it's a precipitation and it records it, all right? And then it disappears as soon as the energy disappears. This went on for several hours over the past day and a half. Now, that energy discharge will go down to ground, okay? Now, that's over here on this side of the planet. It'll go down to ground. It'll go down into the core of the Earth. So what will that do for the rest of the planet? Well, it may excite things back up. Is it any wonder we get a new flurry of deep earthquakes within a day of that happening? It was quiet. There hadn't been any new deep earthquakes in 2 days. And then all of a sudden, boom, 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 several new deep earthquakes. So we have several new deep earthquakes. What does that mean? Longtime viewers, you already know. You know when you see 2, 3, 4 deep earthquakes in a couple days' time, that means there's the potential for shallower, larger earthquake activity to be developing over this week. So this is about to re-flare up again and push over to Europe again and cause new activity in the next few days, going all the way across and terminating in the Mediterranean. That's no exaggeration. You can keep track of this. We're going to be watching over the next several days. I'm not going anywhere. And we're going to be watching this closely and watch the progression spread out. Now, if you're up in Japan, I know I've got a lot of viewers in Japan, maybe a few in Taiwan and Philippines. Here's what's up, guys. This new 6.5 to 6.9 earthquake is going to move to the north and cause new activity to the north. How big? Between 6 and 6.3. 6.3 to the north, and we're going to see 6 to 6.3 to the west. This is going to divide. Look where the earthquake struck. See our arrows? We're right next to the bend that goes to the north and to the south. So the pressure is going to divide on this and go to the north and to the south. So what's to the north? Well, the halfway point between this earthquake and the earthquakes that just struck off the coast of Japan comes in south of Kyushu in the Ryukyu Islands down near Okinawa going up to South Japan. We do have to warn the northeast tip of Taiwan because anything in a 6 range is enough to shake up this whole area. So you can see it. It's the halfway point in between the two sets of earthquakes that will be hit in the next couple days. And it's going to be a combination of the split pressure. So 6 to 6.3 to the north. Now you see the arrows also point to the south. Pressure is going to go down to the south. See where the letter D is and how there's like an S-shape bend here that goes around and into Indonesia. Okay, the pressure is going to come down around past through this S-shape bend and go over to the west. Now it's going to stop halfway between Sinabung and the earthquake. So the 6.5 all the way back here, measure the distance all the way around the bend and you'll get your halfway point. As I see it, the halfway point comes in here into Java going into East Timor. So you would have to straighten out this S-shaped bend and that would give us our rough approximation of a halfway point, and that's what we're going to watch for. Now we're going to watch for the same size magnitude as we're watching to the north. So if it's going to be a 6 to 6.3 to the north, it's going to be a 6 to 6.3 to the south. The pressure is going to be divided in half. But it's not going to stop there. This is all going to happen within the next 72 hours. Then, within the week, within 7 days or less, we're going to see pressure transfer up and out of the West Pacific and begin to strike back at our fulcrum point, our halfway point in Asia. If you live over in eastern Nepal, going into India and Myanmar right here, even South China at the bend, you're going to get hit after this. So it's going to progress out like dominoes and then reach over to North India. North India, Afghanistan, Pakistan border region where the arrows come together. You're not going to get out of this. You're going to get hit too. How big? It'll probably be about the same size as what strikes at Myanmar and China. Now, what size is that going to be? Most likely, it'll be in the mid-range 5 level. Now, why am I coming to a mid-range 5 determination? Well, we got a 6.3 that should strike here within the next 3 days. Then, within a couple days after that, it should pass by and strike with new eruptions at Sinabung. That will delay things for a day. Then, it will press out, but it'll still have a fair amount of energy, even with the volcanic eruption blowing off, and it'll strike at the bend. Striking at the bend, it will have lost about a half magnitude coming up and around, going through the volcanic blast and trying to make the turn to the west, and that will drop the magnitude down by a half magnitude, putting it at the highest end at 5.5. But then it'll keep going. Okay, the pressure will maintain its momentum, and it'll come back into North India, Afghanistan, Pakistan, and cause something like a 5 to 5.3, a few points less than the 5.5 that hits at Myanmar. Then it won't stop there. No, no, no. The pressure will carry on and cause new fours to go across over into Iran. And then we'll get back over here and we'll get into Macedonia again. And this will all happen within the next 6 to 7 days. And Macedonia will be struck again by a new earthquake because the swarm won't have died out by, 4 or 5 days, 6 days from now. It won't have died out. Certainly will not have stopped. And that will then cause a new 5.0 type earthquake to be striking back in Macedonia, which will then re-excite things back up for Italy. And now I'm getting beyond a week and we're getting a little less accurate in the forecast. But that lets you know what the progression is going to be. So I hope I dispelled it out for you. I hope you've got a plan and are prepared in the West Pacific. Now in the United States, it's going to be slightly a different story. The 5.8 is going to be pushing down through Wyoming, Colorado, going across Texas, Oklahoma, Kansas, and the New Madrid seismic zone, then going up the East Coast. Now, we've already seen an excitement happen at Oklahoma. We told you about that this morning. If you go watch my video from this morning when the earthquake struck, I just so happened to be sitting at the computer when the earthquake struck. So as it went ding and popped on the map, I'm there, immediately issued the warning, and we talked about how Oklahoma was most likely going to be the first hit on this. The pressure was going to immediately come down diagonally from the northwest and literally hit right here, push the whole plate. Now, what's going to happen in the next day, 2 days, maybe three at the most, 72 hours, this area in between Colorado, Wyoming, guys, you need to be watching out for earthquake activity to develop, and it could be significant in size. Now, if we just get off with some swarms in Oklahoma, we'll be really, really lucky. Really lucky. But I want you to imagine what's going on here in between the big earthquake up in the northwest and the fracking ops in Oklahoma. That in-between space. Who's in between? Yellowstone, Colorado, New Mexico, Kansas, Oklahoma, and North Texas. That's who's in between. And what do all those states have in common? Well, they're all doing major drilling on the edge of the craton. So I don't need to spell that out for you. It means that there's the potential of larger earthquakes striking at the man-made pumping operations, which we've seen in the past have also caused fatalities when they dispatch people up to go check on the wells when these microquakes and rumbling starts happening at the wells. It happened in Colorado. Let me show you where it happened. So there's no question about it, okay? So looking at this area, let me show you where we are. Here we are in western Colorado. It's kind of sad, actually. Let me just bring it up. Okay, we go back a few years, and this same situation took place. But it didn't happen in Montana. It happened in Challis, Idaho, over here in the Salmon River Mountains in western Idaho, west of Yellowstone. On the western portion of the magma chamber for Yellowstone, there was a 5.0 earthquake and swarm similar to what's happening now in Montana. When that happened, we issued warnings for areas down the edge of the craton. And around the same time, here in western Colorado at a place called Colbran, the fracking operation that's there, there's frack ops here that are built into the foothills, and they go up to the mountaintops. And let me just show you an example, okay? So on the mountaintops, they've drilled into below the mountaintops to fracture the shale and extract natural gas and oil. What they've also done at these frack ops is that they've injected liquid CO2, like what's in a soda bottle, okay? But in these huge trucks, they'll come in and inject liquid CO2 and put it down into the ground. They'll store it forever as a way to fight climate change. They'll put liquid CO2 into these old oil wells. Well, what happened here, the pressure came in, put pressure on one of these CO2 sequestration operations, and it started to rumble. The oil company dispatched people up to go check on the well, and when the people went up there, it was a guy, he took his son and another guy up there. When they got up there, they opened one of the wells, and it exploded like a shook-up can of soda, only with millions of gallons of liquid stored CO2 with liquid sand that came out shooting out like a geyser and exploded like a volcano, and you can clearly see it went up and over the hills. Now, they tried to say this was a lake at the top of the mountain, but it turned out there was no lake. People went back and saw the satellite imagery. There was no lake there. It blew, and now there's a lake forming inside of there. Look at the size of that. A lake forming inside of there because this depression and sinkage. So what does it mean? It means the CO2 sequestration operation came under pressure like a, I don't want to be too gross, but like a pimple or something. It got pushed up, and it's disgusting that it happened, and it killed three people. Okay, and they ignored the warning signs of pressure coming down the plate previously. So if you know anybody who works at those operations, please let them know the Colbran gas story and let them know that these operations are at risk of being under high pressure right now due to the pressure on the edge of the craton. It's not going to go anywhere except for away from the current location. The pressure is going to try to seek a path of least resistance out across the edge of the plate to the east. I think that's due to the rotation of the planet. I'm not quite sure why the pressure seeks these paths from west to east in the United States, Canada, Central America, South America, or why it goes from east to west across Europe and back out. I believe it's due to the rotation of the planet, maybe the hemispheres. I don't know. I would have to get out there and do some geophysics measurements, getting out and like measuring the core of the Earth somehow, satellites or something. I don't know. Don't even know where to begin with that. So now you have a good idea of what's going on. I want you to have a plan. So the people that were woken up in the middle of the night here, okay, people who were woken up in the middle of the night by a 5.8, guys, in the Midwest here in Oklahoma and Kansas, you could be woken up by a 4.8, one magnitude less. Now, we've seen fours and fives take off chimneys, knock facades off houses, cause damage on the inside of houses, cause damage to infrastructure, bridges, water pipes, sewer systems. So these are all things that you have to be prepared for. Now, there's certain things that are out of your hands, the sewer systems, the water, right? But you can have preps and plans in place that deal with that. Now, I'm not talking about big stockpiles of food and water. My first response would be, first of all, you need to be able to take shelter and protect yourself from falling debris in an earthquake. So you get a 6.0 earthquake, it's big enough to knock things off shelves, big enough to cause damage in your house. So the first thing is, if you're in the middle of the night and things are falling off the shelves and breaking, you need a set of shoes by the side of your bed, right? Then you're going to need a bug out bag or some kind of bag with a flashlight in it. There were power outages last night due to this earthquake. Power outages. So your power's out. It's dark in your house. It's the middle of the night. Things are breaking and falling off shelves. Think about it. Planning ahead of time makes a big difference. So when we talk about these earthquakes, I don't want you to be scared. I want you to be prepared. The big difference, it's like a firefighter or a soldier. I mean, sure, battle's scary, and sure, fires are scary. And sure, the people that are going into the fires and going into the battles, they're probably got a good sense of fear, but they're bottling that fear, and they're replacing that panic with preparation. Training. So your training kicks in. It becomes a knee-jerk reaction. You hear about that. You've heard that term before, knee-jerk reaction. Okay, I want your knee-jerk reaction to earthquakes to be taking shelter underneath something to protect your body and your head. Because what good are you if you're the injured one? you got a piece of drywall that falls out of the, or a plaster that falls out of the ceiling. You'll feel stupid for not being under a table. You get it sticking out of your head or you're knocked out. What good are you then? Are you good to your friends, family, loved one, coworker, anyone if you're knocked out or bleeding or something? No. So think about taking care of yourself as soon as the earthquake hits. It's also like the principle that's applied in an airplane. When an airplane depressurizes and loses most of the oxygen in the cabin, all the things come down, the little breathing mask, and the first thing they tell you to do is to affix the mask to your face, because then you can then start helping other people. But what good are you if you're one of the people that are passed out in their seat? So just think about it. So we're looking at the potential of an increase in the United States going all the way across the edge of the craton. Four and upper four activity is potential in the fracking operations in the Midwest, and 3.0 activity going up into Quebec, north of New York, going maybe possibly into Maine and New Brunswick, but southeast Quebec needs to be put on watch. Southern states, the fill-in here, you might see some twos popping off, but again, it's not that big of a deal, more on the East Coast. But when you see something like this, you do have to warn for it. Again, what if I'm wrong? What if I'm wrong and instead of a three, a four hits? That's big enough to cause damage. Or what if I'm way wrong? I'm looking for a three and a five hits. Pressure maintains itself across the edge of the craton. And for the people that are in between, well, I mean, I am going to have to mention the New Madrid seismic zone, but I don't want anybody to panic. I live right here, okay? So I live in the middle of it all, right here in St. Louis, Missouri. Down to the south is the New Madrid seismic zone. We would watch here for swarm activity, similar in size to what's going to be striking on the East Coast. We want to thank the people in Oklahoma, the people in Kansas, the people in Colorado and Wyoming and Texas for making yourselves the new Madrid seismic zone. I mean, we can't thank you enough. The people of Chicago, the people of St. Louis, the people of Memphis, Tennessee, people of Indianapolis, Indiana. Well, you know what? Again, we're glad you guys are all getting a $1 million check, every one of you in every one of your houses, for becoming that. You know, I mean, you're making billions and billions of dollars. We're so glad that you're getting paid to become this. And there is no taking it back. So Humpty Dumpty's broken. You are the new Madrid seismic zone. You will always catch the pressure from now on coming from the west and northwest. It used to be caught here at the bend, where it couldn't make the transition around the bend. It was too big of a bend. So the pressure would get caught here, build here, and release in large earthquakes. But now you have stepped in and drilled 100,000 times, God knows how many times, across the edge of the craton and made yourselves the new Madrid seismic zone. Okay, and we thank you for that. Now, I'm being sarcastic that you guys are getting a $1 million check per person. You should get paid. Every person in the state should get paid. You should all get a check. The state shouldn't make a dime. The state's not a company, or are they? Are they a for-profit company? Is Oklahoma and Kansas a for-profit corporation? They better not be, and if they are, you better pass a law that says they can't be. Make them a charity or something. But if they're collecting money, you guys should all get a check every month. Every one of you, at least several thousand dollars per month, you should get, every person in the state, for becoming the new Madrid seismic zone, the new Madrid, and for assuming that responsibility for the whole country. Okay, anything else going on? Oh, I do want to mention something else that I've been promising to mention. How many people are in here right now? 775? Okay, guys, MC Player, who's in our chat room, he's a moderator, he's a teenager. Okay, he's 24 years younger than me, I'm 40. So he's a teenager, and he's worked on a earthquake global feed for Earthquake 3D. Now, I'm going to try and get it set up here on my PC. You guys know I've been having issues with my PC, so I've been kind of dreading to even mess around with anything here. But it's pretty simple. If you guys have a full copy of Earthquake 3D, you can actually install this global feed that MC Player's made, and it'll give you all the international feeds, at least as many as he could find and get translated to work on Earthquake 3D. We're talking about having more information available than IRIS, USGS, any of the big boys. Now, I'm going to try and get it set up here in the next couple days on the stream so that you guys can see it, and I'll show you how it works. It works just like regular Earthquake 3D, but it's all the feeds in the planet. If you guys use the USGS, oh man, you're screwed. You're screwed. If you're using the USGS or IRIS, you don't even talk to me, Because if you're just using those two sources, you're not even one-fourth aware of what's going on the planet. We are certain, beyond a shadow of a doubt, that the USGS missed several hundred 5.0 and greater earthquakes last year. Several hundred. And we are certain, beyond a shadow of a doubt, that the USGS and other large agencies are deleting earthquakes that are striking in areas where we warn. Either that, or I can forecast human mistakes and computer mistakes. Because this week, a 7.1 was reported in Nunavut, we issued a warning for Nunavut, and they deleted the earthquake. This week, a 7.0, 6.9 earthquake struck on the side or western side of Papua New Guinea. We issued a warning for Papua New Guinea, and they deleted the earthquake. Those two sevens right there, those aren't the only ones, guys. Those are just two good examples. We have others, just from this past week. So I'm going to have to say earthquakes are being either, I mean, again, we have to apply Occam's razor. Either I am capable of forecasting human mistakes and computer mistakes multiple times, also capable of forecasting military tests and mine collapses, or Occam's razor here, or there's somebody out there who's controlling this and is threatened, because they are, and they came to my pages. That's another part of the Occam's razor, is that the people who are threatened by this, the big agencies, came and sent their best people against me. The geophysics medal winner, Professor John Vidali, came against me and tried to stop my fundraisers. He came to my fundraisers, not a troll, but really him using his public pages from the institution and the Pacific Northwest Seismic Network to try to stop my fundraisers. That lets you know how threatened they are. So earthquakes get deleted off a feed and they're striking in spots where we warn. I have to get a little bit suspect and call it out for what I see it is. Either I can forecast mistakes or they're deleting earthquakes that are striking in areas that we name. They've already come against me personally. Which do you think is the most likely answer? I'm capable of forecasting mistakes? That's even more preposterous than forecasting earthquakes. Right? Okay, so word up to my people. And I will be back on at a moment's notice if anything else goes down. I'm going to save this as a video on my channel so you guys can share it. If you know anybody who lives in one of these areas, I can quickly explain it to you so you can explain it to them. The people that are in these areas, the silent zones. Silent zones are the spots that are missing earthquakes. I think that's pretty obvious. And you add the earthquakes up on both sides of the silent zones, or all sides of the silent zones, and that will give you the earthquake that strikes in the middle within a few days' time. So if you look here, for instance, it's a great example right in the middle right here. This is eastern Papua New Guinea going into the Solomon Islands. It's a silent zone. There have been no new eruptions here and no new earthquakes in the past day and a half to 2 days. That means, actually, in 4 or 5 days, there haven't been any new earthquakes. Now, there were eruptions happening at Langila Volcano here, but that stopped. That means this middle point is under stress, and it's going to be hit. How big? It should be at least one magnitude larger than our new deep earthquake, which was a 4.4. So 5.4 potential is existing right here. Anybody shocked? There was just a 5.4 right here. So another 5.4 is likely to strike within the next 48 to 72 hours right in the middle. And a 5.4 is big enough to cause damage in Papua New Guinea. We've seen that happen before. Let the people know they're sandwiched between two spots that are moving and they haven't been hit in several days. You're the middle point. You're going to get hit next by the combined total of the earthquakes on both sides. So if you know somebody in Papua New Guinea, when you warn them, you don't just contact them and say, watch out for an earthquake 5.4. You say, watch out for an earthquake 5.4 because you are sandwiched in between two areas that are moving, Philippines and Fiji. And you're the middle point. If you're going to warn somebody up in Japan, you would tell them the same thing. You would say, look, you're in the Ryukyu Islands in South Japan. You're sandwiched in between a 6.9 to the south and a 5.1 to the north, which means in the middle, you're going to be seeing a combination, right? I mean, it's basic. It's basic logic. You're the halfway point between the two zones that are moving. Fulcrum point gets hit. It's going to get hit in the next couple days. It's nothing to panic them over either because the size is only going to be in the 6 range to the north and the 6 range to the south. That's the good news. But with these new deep earthquakes, that is what I'm keeping an eye on. If we start seeing more new deep earthquakes tonight and tomorrow, we're going to watch out for the potential of going up into 7.0 and mid-range 7.0 activity in the next few days. But I don't want to get ahead of myself. I want you to be prepared for what's going on right now. Going on in the next several days, I'll be here tomorrow to do another update, and we'll let you know how it looks with the deep events. Okie dokie. That's all we got. Let me stop recording, and we will save this as a video over on YouTube, and I'll be right back on in a few minutes. Guys, this afternoon or evening, I think we're going to go through and answer some of the mail that was sent to me by viewers from around the country. So I said I was going to do that last night, but then we had our big earthquake activity and kind of got sidetracked on that. So word up. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, or good night, Truman Show style. And I'll be back on in a few. Peace out.